going to do is just pick up where we left off this morning and examine what the Apostle Paul here is doing in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. I want to begin reading at verse 16. Rejoice evermore, pray without ceasing, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Quench not the Spirit, despise not prophesyings, prove all things, hold fast that which is good, abstain from all appearance of evil, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly, and I pray God your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Again, Father, we thank you for who you are as a loving, kind, and gracious Father. We thank you for eternal life, which you give as a free gift, and we thank you for your word so that we can know you in a richer and deeper way. We pray that as we continue to examine this specific passage of Scripture, may we have a grasp in what it is you're seeking to accomplish, and may we take the doctrine to heart, and certainly may it exalt our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Just heard something to my left. I don't know what that was, but I don't know if there was ice falling out in the window, whatever that was. But anyway, we're going to pick it up here in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. If you were here this morning, we were focusing in on verse 16 specifically. What I wish to do this evening is focus on verse 17. But if you allow me a few minutes of review, if you recall, what the apostle here is doing is he's giving very quick, abbreviated exhortations, okay? And if you notice, verse 16, rejoice evermore. Verse 17, pray without ceasing. Verse 18, in everything, give thanks. And you wonder, why is Paul just providing this very abbreviated, quick instruction? And the reason for that is, it's very fitting when you understand the spiritual nature there at Thessalonica. The Thessalonians are at a higher level of spiritual understanding. They're operating at a level of spiritual maturity. So what you have the Apostle Paul doing is he's not going to spend a great deal of time amplifying and expounding upon what it is he's pressing upon the saints there at Thessalonica. And please, when I say the saints at Thessalonica, we understand by default that includes the entire church, the body of Christ. So what we find is he provides these very quick tidbits of instruction, the assumption being that the Thessalonians are very familiar with the doctrine that the Apostle Paul is referring to. In other words, for example, verse 16, when Paul instructs, rejoice evermore, it's assumed that the saints understand what it means to rejoice. So what Paul is going to do is he sort of reminds the believer that we need to rejoice evermore. And what we can now do is recall information and doctrine that has already been provided. So in other words, we start unpacking the specific doctrine that Paul is concentrating on. So that once again is very characteristic of how Paul is dealing with the saints at Thessalonica, because they are operating at a higher level of spirituality, okay? So with that in mind, I want to once again just quickly glance at verse 23. We mentioned this morning, often when we read verse 23, we read it as though this is an additional set of information, or there is this addition that is now provided for. And in reality, when we read verse 23, Paul isn't saying "and" in the sense of addition. He's not saying, okay, here is all this information, verses 16 through verse 22, and in addition, I pray that the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. What verse 23 is doing is describing the result of verses 16 through verse 22. In other words, if the believer heeds the information that Paul is given here in verses 16 through verse 22, the resultant is, guess what? Our whole spirit, soul, and body will be preserved blameless. So the "and" is an "and" of explanation. Verse 23 is the expected consequence of following the doctrine that Paul is issuing in the previous verses. That now tells us that verse 23 is a template. So when we look at verse 23, and Paul says, listen, if we rejoice, if we pray, if we give thanks, if we quench not the Spirit, if we despise not prophesying, if we abstain from all appearance of evil, if we prove all things, then what we learn is our entire anatomy, our spirit, soul, and body will be sanctified, and it will be preserved. Okay? So if we use verse 23 as a sort of template, we have a very natural delineation here. We find that the realm of the Spirit will correspond with verses 16 through verse 18. We learn that the soul will correlate with verses 19 and 20. And then we can conclude that the realm of the body correlates with verses 21 and verse 22. In other words, this template, how is the soul impacted? How is the spirit impacted? How is the soul impacted? And how is the body impacted? Well, Paul just told you. If he's telling us, this is the result. Okay? So when we kind of diagram it this way, we have a very natural order. This isn't some arbitrary order that Paul is providing. So if we use this template, that'll help us understand what Paul is seeking to achieve here in this particular passage. Now, in verse 23, the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. We understand when Paul uses the word wholly, he's talking about the whole spirit, soul, and body. Then notice in verse 23, I pray, God, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless. I mentioned this morning, people oftentimes will read this as though Paul is appealing to God to somehow supernaturally intervene on behalf of the believer and ensure that the believer's spirit, soul, and body is preserved. But Paul is not appealing to God. He is appealing to the Thessalonians to ensure that you take proactive steps that will now preserve your spirit, soul, and body. So the prayer is for us. Again, don't read it as, oh, wow, I hope God will do this for you. Rather, I hope and I pray that if you take heed to the exhortations that he just listed from verse 16 to verse 22, it will result in the preservation of our spirit, soul, and body. It isn't God who's going to change. Paul isn't suggesting, oh, I pray God moves. Rather, I pray you Thessalonians take heed to the doctrine that I'm just referring to here, okay? The word preserve carries with it the idea of guarding or protecting or keeping something. So what Paul here is praying for the believer is for the believer to protect. We have to take deliberate steps to proactively protect our spirit, our soul, and our body so that it is, quote, Paul says, blameless. That is, free and innocent from wrongdoing. We're innocent and free from guilt. We don't want to be guilty in doing things that will result in our spirit, soul, and body being victimized, okay? So, again, Paul is dealing with mature saints. And it isn't, oh, I hope God does it. I hope you do this. So, with that in mind, we need to think about what is it that I can do to protect my spirit? Now, we're not going to go through all these verses as we did this morning. When Paul talks about the spirit, he isn't suggesting that we have to guard this metaphysical, invisible part of who we are, but rather, a number of times, whether it's Romans, Corinthians, so on, a number of times, Paul refers to the spirit in relationship to our demeanor, in relationship to our mental disposition, in relationship to our spiritual attitude. So, in other words, number one, Paul, in verses 16, 17, and 18, he supplies this abbreviated reminder to take us back to doctrines already learned, doctrines that have already been provided for, and we now can go back to the doctrines that we've learned and begin to sort of extract the details. Paul's not going to give the details. There's no reason to give the details. We should be familiar with the doctrine. And if we go back and extract and unpack that specific category of doctrine, for example, rejoice evermore, well, that's going to result in protecting my spirit from being guilty of something. Well, if Paul is referring to the spirit in relationship to our attitude, what Paul is saying, for example, in verse 16, we need to rejoice. What would be the opposite of rejoicing? Well, we don't want to be victimized by, again, that toxic, hyper, poisonous, cynical, critical, mean spirit and attitude that all too often possesses a culture and a society. I think you would agree with me. You watch television long enough, you hear the radio long enough, you read newspapers and magazines long enough, you find that there is this hostile, aggressive spirit that grips the world. And we should not be guilty, by the way, blameless. Don't be guilty of falling victim to that sour, pessimistic, dark, poisonous attitude. Instead, verse 16, rejoice evermore. We evermore, not only in quantity, but in quality. We should experience the intensification of joy. So we have to deliberately protect ourselves from becoming pessimistic, sour, and becoming cynical. Okay? If we don't protect ourselves, God's not going to supernaturally do it for us. So we ask the question this morning, rejoice. Well, how do we do that? What is the cause and source of rejoicing? And what we did this morning is we saw that it begins in Romans chapter 5, right? Well, what we'll do now we're going to pick it up. We're going to pick it up now at verse 17. And notice what we read in verse 17. Pray without ceasing. Well, if we protect, by the way, how do we protect and guard our spirit? Rejoice, pray, thanksgiving. Those are the three doctrines that we want to bring to our recollection. We want to go back. We want to dig the weeds. We want to extract. We want to unpack those specific areas of doctrine. And if we recognize those are the three exhortations that will help us guard our spirit from falling victim to the, again, the poisonous spirit that we oftentimes find. Well, we have joy or rejoicing. Secondly, verse 17, we're supposed to pray. What happens is we guard against becoming indifferent. We guard against being cold and apathetic. When we understand the doctrines that are intended to preserve our soul, well, we guard against being ignorant. Now, we're not going to talk about what it means to quench the spirit and so forth or despise prophesying. Just remember this. Our spiritual, the attitude that we're supposed to have in contrast to the world, we guard against becoming indifferent and careless. The second realm, or the second part of anatomy, the soul, Paul's supplying some doctrine that will guard against becoming ignorant. And that's what he's dealing with. And then the third area, the body, Paul is going to provide reminders to specific doctrines so that we can guard against becoming idle. So we don't want to be indifferent. We don't want to be spiritually ignorant. And we don't want to be idle, spiritually of no profit or use. We want to be meat for the master's use. So those are the three areas, okay? And again, I just want to remind everyone, we need to take deliberate steps to achieve that target. God's not going to push the buttons. There's no joy button. There's no joy formula. There's no joy recipe. There's no joy pill. Well, verse 17, pray without ceasing. So you wonder, okay, Why and how does prayer protect my attitude, my demeanor, my disposition? Well, prayer will guard against the vile, corruptive, of poisonous effects of the world. But when Paul says, pray without ceasing, we, again, have to start thinking, has Paul taught anything about prayer? And, of course, the answer is absolutely yes. So by the time we get to the last church epistles in the canon of Scripture, Paul's canon of Scripture, the Thessalonian letters are the last church epistles, okay? When we're now at the sort of the capstone here, the last church epistles, all he says is, pray without ceasing. Do it. But the assumption is, we know how to do it. We know when to do it. We know why to do it. We know what expectations there are when we do it. So you see what I'm getting at? It isn't just, well, just do it. Pray without ceasing. Does the Apostle Paul provide specific information concerning the doctrine of prayer? He provided specific doctrine regarding joy. And where did we go this morning to first learn about joy? The book of Romans. Why would we find the foundational doctrine on rejoicing in the book of Romans? That's where we find the foundational doctrines. So it is, if Paul says pray without ceasing, okay, let's think about the Pauline doctrine of prayer. And it would be very fitting if we go to the book of Romans. So, let's go to Romans chapter 8. Just like this morning, when we talk about rejoicing, we found in Romans chapter 5, specifically, the first time we read about the reason we rejoice, and this morning we saw, we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And Paul develops that theme, Paul develops that doctrine throughout his epistles. So by the time we get to 1 Thessalonians 5, all he needs to say is rejoice evermore. You know what we're talking, you know what I'm talking about. You already have been supplied all of the details. You know the doctrine. Bring it to your recollection. Unpack it. And now experience it. Do it. And guess what happens? Your spirit will be protected from the victimization of what's happening out there in the world. If that's true with joy or rejoicing, Romans chapter 8, it's also true when it comes to the doctrine of prayer. There are three things that I want to point out here this evening. Paul does three things in light of prayer. Romans chapter 8, now the verse specifically that we find the first time, Paul supplies doctrine regarding prayer. And to me, it is absolutely telling what he's going to do here in verse 26. Romans chapter 8, verse 26. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. The first thing that is striking in verse 26 is he introduces the doctrine of prayer to the Romans by default, to the body of Christ in this current dispensation, in this foundational epistle, with a negative approach. Interestingly, in verse 26, Paul informs us, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. That's the first feature that we discover when we want to learn about prayer, Pauline prayer, and that's going to be the key here. The second feature that we notice is, again in verse 26, likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our what? Infirmities. So the second characteristic when we begin to examine and study Pauline prayer is, wait a minute, the Holy Spirit is interested in helping. Now that's critically important. Not removing or eliminating, but he wishes to help, according to verse 26, our infirmities. And it's in that context, what does Paul say? We don't know how to pray for as we ought, do we? So, wait a minute. We're going to now begin to learn about Pauline prayer. We find it in the context of infirmities. Secondly, Paul says, but we don't know how we ought to pray. And that's kind of a little odd. Because frankly, we're going to go through these verses. There's been a lot of praying going on before the book of Romans. And there are a lot of examples of prayer. There are a lot of men and women of God that are actively engaged in prayer. And not only that, you have the Lord Jesus Christ himself teaching his disciples how to pray. But when we come to Paul, he says to the body of Christ, we don't know how to pray as we ought. Kind of interesting. You know what he's telling us? Anything you ever learned about prayer before me, Paul, jettison it. Just sort of think about this for a second. There's a dispensational point that's being made here. So, before we go any further, the context is infirmity. Secondly, Paul tells us we don't know how to do it as we ought. And then thirdly, and I don't know if we're going to get to this, but thirdly, in connection to Pauline prayer, let's read verse 26 now again. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercessions for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Now notice verse 27. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. The Apostle Paul in verse 27, he's going to borrow from some passages in connection to prayer where he tells us in verse 27, he that searcheth the hearts. So the third feature regarding Pauline prayer is prayer is intended to be a two-directional level of communion between the believer and God the Father, where God the Father is searching the believer's heart. Now, I want to be careful. That's not to suggest that God is ignorant and doesn't know our heart unless we pray. Be careful. I don't believe that's what Paul is saying here. There are some that believe that God doesn't know what you're thinking or what's on your heart unless you verbalize it. And I don't believe that is what's happening here at all. But the point is this. When Paul introduces to the body of Christ the doctrine of Pauline prayer, the third feature has something to do with God the Father searching our hearts. So that's kind of interesting. That helps us understand that the old prayer program, the time past prayer program, is no longer in operation. And that's what Paul's getting at. So anything we might have learned about prayer previous to Paul, we're going to have to jettison it because Paul's telling us we don't know how to pray for as we ought. Paul is going to provide more information, more detail, of course, by inspiration, by God himself, that'll give us all of the necessary details so that we can frame a proper understanding of how we're to pray today. By the way, when Paul says we know not how to pray for as we ought, I believe that's a temporary condition, because when we get to Ephesians, Paul actually tells the Ephesians, pray with understanding. So we're not there yet when we're in Romans. Romans is a foundational epistle, okay? Now, just get a feel very quickly for the immediate. In this immediate context, Paul brings up the issue of prayer. It actually goes back to verse 17. Let's go back to verse 17 quickly and just get a feel for what Paul's doing here. Verse 17, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. Verse 18, for I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. So Paul is preparing the body of Christ for the inevitable experience called sufferings. That's interesting, because that is in stark contrast to what God informed the nation of Israel about suffering. What Paul's going to do is prepare the body of Christ to go through suffering. And what he's ultimately going to demonstrate is, just because we're members of the body of Christ and we're in the dispensation of grace does not mean we're immune from the potentiality, from the potential suffering. In fact, in verse 18, notice he calls it this present time. You can argue that Paul's talking about that historic point in time 2,000 years ago where you find the Romans under the oppressive dominion of Nero, for example, of Caesar. You can make the case that, well, when Paul's talking about the sufferings of this present time, that is 2,000 years ago, where unfortunately the Christian was hotly persecuted, hotly treated, hostily treated. Back 2,000 years ago, you're familiar with the Colosseum, for example, Christians that are being thrown out to the lions, being thrown out to the bears, and Christianity being an illegal religion, and it was an illegal religion. So we know that in his present day, there was the outbreak of persecution and hostility against the Christian. But I don't believe that Paul is suggesting that it's a suffering that is unique to his specific time in history. When Paul uses the expression present suffering, that includes the entire present dispensation. In other words, suffering is going to be a characteristic of the present dispensation of grace. Now, why would Paul have to do that? When building the foundation, when Paul provides the first principles of grace, why is it that he would equate the present time with the sufferings of this present time? Because we must remember, dispensationally, sufferings were a sign that God was displeased. Whereas in this present time period of sufferings, it's not because God is displeased. Dispensationally, go quickly, for example, to Deuteronomy. Let's go dispensationally, Deuteronomy chapter 28. Dispensationally, if the nation of Israel was suffering some sort of punishment, if they were experiencing some type of suffering, whether it came by way of enemies at war, if it came by way of famine, if it came by way of meteorological catastrophe, if it came by way of economic disaster, if it came by way of physical illness and disease and infirmity, if it came by way of losing your posterity, losing your children and grandchildren, God clearly told Israel, that's the result of my anger and chastisement against you as a nation. What Paul is pressing to us is, if we're suffering, it has nothing to do with God being angry or God punishing or God chastising or God sending a message or God trying to get our attention. Sufferings in this present time are a natural part of our experience. But that was not true in time past. And I did ask you to go to Deuteronomy 28. Deuteronomy 28 is one of the more obvious chapters that demonstrate that sufferings were a sign. And if Israel was in rebellion, God would punish them by way of various levels and various intensities of suffering. Deuteronomy chapter 28. Now, if you begin reading Deuteronomy 28, verses 1, all the way down to verse 13, you know what God says to the nation of Israel? I will bless you. God says to the nation of Israel, verse 1, and it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all these commandments which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth, and all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee. Verse 3, blessing. Verse 4, blessed. Verse 5, blessed. Verse 6, blessed. And you go down this entire list, and God makes this promise of overflowing bounty of riches and free from threat of enemies and free from the threat of economic collapse and so on. And it sounds like a good bargain. All I got to do is listen to God and believe Him and obey Him and be faithful to Him and observe all of the commandments. So if I can live my life in perfect continuous harmony and steadfastness and always faithfully carry out the laws and the ordinances and the commandments, and if the entire nation of Israel could do so, they would have the legitimate expectation to be the reigning kingdom on the earth. They would be on high above all the nations. They would experience this overwhelming blessing from God. And you read all of the different levels of blessing. But here's the problem with the law. It was conditional, wasn't it? You do it, you can expect overflowing blessing. But there's a condition. If you don't do it, then you know what God threatened the nation of Israel? Verse 15, but it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God to observe to do all His commandments and His statutes which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. Verse 16, cursed. Verse 17, cursed. Verse 18, cursed. Verse 19, cursed. And you go down through this entire list, and what God does is He provides stomach-turning details regarding the type and level of suffering Israel's going to experience. Verse 24, the Lord shall make the rain of thy land powder. God says, you're going to experience drought. And what happens when you have drought? You have famine. God says in verse 25, you're going to have war. In verse 27, the Lord will smite thee with the botch of Egypt. God says, you're going to experience physical diseases. Verse 28, you're going to be smitten with madness. You're going to suffer lunacy. Verse 30, you're going to lose your wives. You're going to lose your home. You're going to lose your land. Verse 31, you're going to lose all of your material possessions. Verse 32, you're going to lose your sons. You're going to lose your daughters. You're going to lose your children. And then there in verse 35, the Lord shall smite thee in the knees and in the legs. You're going to experience physical infirmity. The goal, verse 45, moreover, all these curses shall come upon thee and shall pursue thee and overtake thee till thou be destroyed. Verse 46, and they shall be upon thee for a what? A sign, and for a wonder, and upon thy seed forever. So just grasp the dispensational program that God established with Israel. If you do well, I'll bless you. If you disobey, rebel, you fall victim to apostasy, and you are engaged in rank rebel, God said, I'm going to curse you until I destroy you. All of these cursings are a sign. So think about that. What if, verse 35, the Lord shall smite thee in the knees? A lot of women in this assembly need knee replacement. My wife had double knee replacement. In fact, just this morning, there was talking to a woman back there. She needs to have a knee replacement. Could I have gone to verse 35 and say, hey, you know what? There's a verse in the Bible where God says that if you're disobedient, He's going to smite thee in the knees. Now, do I have a verse that I could have gone to? You know, by the way, there are preachers that do go to Deuteronomy 28. You know, I think one of the most disgusting, most appalling things that I've heard preachers do, and this is true. Look there at verse 32. Thy sons and thy daughters shall be given unto another people, and thine eyes shall look and fail with longing for them all the day long, and there shall be no might in thy hand. You know, there are parents that have go to verse 30. Thou shalt betroth a wife, and another man shall lie with her. Thou shalt build a house, and thou shalt not dwell therein. Thou shalt plant a vineyard, and shall not gather the grapes thereof. There are preachers that will say, listen, you lost your wife, it's because God's punishing you. You lost a child, it's because God is punishing you. You lost your home, it's because God is punishing you. And guess what verses they use? It's Bible. It's scriptural. Deuteronomy 28. But what's the problem? You could be scriptural and absolutely wrong. So, for what we're looking at this evening, God says, here's the sign. You're suffering. I'm doing it against you. It's my fault. I'm doing this as a sign to get you right, to get you to confess, to get you to repent, to get you back, and to get you to be loyal, law-abiding people. And if you straighten out, then I'll remove the curse and I'll bless you. And the blessing is a sign. So if you have the best home, if you have the nicest family, if you have the largest bank account, if you're experiencing wealth, health, and prosperity, well, that's God as a sign telling you, I'm on your side because you're faithful. Now, with that in mind, go back to Romans chapter. You know what Paul's going to do in Romans chapter 8? He is going to spend some time emphasizing the fact in this present time, sufferings are normal. And it has nothing to do with God manifesting his just anger against a believer today. Being blessed physically or being cursed physically has nothing to do with God. And that is, remember, Romans is a first principles book. It's a foundational book. It's laying out the milk doctrine. And so it's, there is a very deliberate reason why Paul in this milk doctrine epistle is talking about suffering. Well, look there, verse 18, for I reckon that the sufferings of this present time. Notice what Paul's going to say about it. He doesn't say, well, you better get right with God. Are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity and not willingly, but by reason of him who has subjected the same in hope. This is, I love verse 20. God deliberately struck creation with death. That to me, I always, when I think about verse 20, the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly. Listen, did any of us ask to die? Did the vegetable creation ask to die? Did the animal creation ask to die? Why is there death all over creation? According to verse 20, not willingly, but by reason of God had a reason why he cursed creation with the sentence of death. Now, this is what he did do. But by reason of him who has subjected the same in hope. By the way, you know why God deliberately struck creation with the penalty of death? Because there was no way he was going to let the adversary have any kind of control over a creation that would not die. Think about that. So God in his wisdom deliberately did that. But for our point, verse 21, because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now, and not only they, but ourselves what? Also. Which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption to it, the redemption. You know what Paul's answer to the physical corruption and decay? You know what he says? You got to wait for the redemption of our body. That's the answer. So remember, the present time sufferings carries with it an important dispensational teaching, which is suffering is part and parcel of our experience. It's just a normal thing to happen. And even we who have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we groan. We're going to experience it all, but yet we're given a hope. We wait for the adoption. Verse 24, for we are saved by hope, but hope that is not seen is not hope, for what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? So this is the answer. Don't look to Deuteronomy 28 and conclude, did I do something wrong? No, you didn't do anything wrong. You're part of a sin-cursed creation, and what God has done, he's done something so that we can endure it all. Real quickly, drop down to verse 37. Verse 35, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Verse 37, nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. The entire half, the last section of Romans chapter 8 is focused on freeing us from the erroneous idea and teaching that when bad things happen to my life, I must have done something wrong. Paul obliterates that error. He demolishes that bad logic and line of thinking. No, accept it. That's what's going to happen. It's the norm. But what God says is we're more than conquerors in it. We actually can transcend the adversity and the difficult circumstances and situations of life. So we have an entirely new way of thinking about suffering, and we got to reorient our thinking about suffering. If we're stuck in Deuteronomy, we're going to be victimized. We're going to be discouraged and depressed, and we're going to be in despair. If we're not careful and we think that that's how God is treating the believer today, we're going to be terrorized. So we got to guard, we got to protect our attitude. We got to know bad things happen, it's okay. It's not your fault. Necessarily. Now, I'm not talking about dumb things that we do, okay? I'm not talking about whatsoever a man soweth, so shall he reap, correct? No, we're talking about, hey, just the physical sufferings that are going to happen. So with that in mind, here we go, verse 26. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. The first thing Paul wants us to understand, how do we pray without ceasing? Well, wait a minute. I know how I can protect my attitude, my demeanor, my disposition, and instead of becoming disgruntled and angry and sour and negative and cynical because all sorts of bad things are happening in my life, accept it. God says there's a hope, and our hope is the redemption of our body. So guess what prayer is intended to do? Pray without ceasing. When the negative things happen, the adverse things happen, when things which appear as though they're destructive, no, they're not destructive at all. Pray without ceasing. When you're going through hardship, pray. And that'll protect us from having a poisonous attitude. I've known believers that they, quote, give up on God. They have a real bad attitude about God. And you know why? Because God never answers my prayers. Oh, by the way, I mentioned on Thursday, how many of your prayers have been answered by God? All of them. If we understand Pauline prayer, they've all been answered. The problem is we have wrong expectations when it comes to prayer. Number one, understand the present time suffering is something that is a natural part of our experience. Prayer is intended to help us. But notice verse 26 again. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. Again, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. That, to me, is just absolutely striking. Go over to Luke chapter 11, and we're going to go further into the Old Testament. Luke chapter 11. Why does Paul say we don't know how to pray as we ought? And yet, now this is an important verse regarding prayer. Okay, now we're not right for tonight. We're not, you know, prayer is pouring out your soul. Prayer is expressing the things that are in your heart. Prayer is communing with God. Prayer is talking with God. Prayer ultimately is literally rehearsing back to our Heavenly Father that which occupies our mind. So prayer is not a formula. Prayer is not a magic foot. Prayer is not a genie's bottle. Prayer is simply talking to our Heavenly Father. Okay, in and of itself, that's all prayer is. We have to learn something about our expectations. But this is a critical point here. Luke chapter 11, and notice there at verse 1, and it came to pass that as he was praying in a certain place, when he ceased, one of his disciples said unto him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples. And he said unto them, when ye pray, say, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And you understand the quote, so-called Lord's Prayer. Here's my point. Is prayer taught according to verse 1? Yes. Didn't they ask, teach us how to what? Pray. So think about this. We have an example in the Gospels during the Messianic ministry when the disciples asked to be taught how to pray. Jesus Christ says, when you pray, this is what you say. Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, and you're probably very familiar with that. Question, by reading Luke chapter 11, verses 1 down through verse 4, do we learn something about prayer? I mean, we do learn something about prayer, don't we? The Lord says, I'll teach you. What does Paul say in Romans chapter 8? We don't know what to pray for as we ought. Wait a minute, Paul. I just read Luke chapter 11. How can Paul says we don't know what to pray for as we ought? Why can't I say, give us, verse 3, give us this, give us day by day our daily bread. Now in Matthew, it's give us this day our daily bread. Verse 4, and forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone that is indebted to us. And lead us not into, wait a minute, Paul, how can you say we don't know what to pray for? According to the Lord Jesus Christ, I can pray for daily bread. I can pray for forgiveness of sins. I can pray that the Lord not lead me into temptation. I can pray that God deliver us from evil. But you know what Paul says? We don't know what we're doing. Do you see the dispensational significance of what Paul is saying? We have no right to go to the Lord Jesus to learn how to pray. If Paul, the apostle of the Gentiles, who is God's man for the age, tells us, we don't know what to pray for as we ought. You see what I'm getting at here? This is just interesting. What Paul is saying, anything you've learned about prayer before me is not applicable in the dispensation of grace. Let's go back, for example, to Exodus chapter 32. Now, we only have a few minutes here, but I just want to quickly notice some of the prayers, and again, if we take prayer as simply communing with God, again, it isn't just, you know, on your knees, it's not a physical position. Again, it's not some formula, Hail Mary, you know, kind of a thing. It's not vain repetition like the Lord Jesus would instruct his disciples. We understand all that. Prayer, fundamentally, is talking to God. You know, the only direct contact that we have with God today outside of what he is telling us through Scripture is when you talk to him. That's the only point of contact that we have outside of his word. We get to talk. We have direct access to God. And the thing that really is, he wants us to talk to him. Isn't that interesting? God is telling us, pray without ceasing. So prayer is not one-directional. A lot of religious systems, whether it's Islam, whether it's Hinduism, whether it's Buddhism, I mean, when you look at prayer practices among religion, it's very one-directional. I'm telling you this. I'm requesting this. I'm desiring that. And it's just this one-directional, just sort of, but that isn't how God desires us to pray. There is this two-direct, he searcheth the hearts. Now, we're not going to be able to get to that, but that to me is very significant. He's not a genie floating around waiting for every request. He actually views prayer as that intimate time in which he's searching our thinking. He's searching our heart. Not because he's ignorant, but he so desires our thinking to be in perfect alignment with his will and his thinking. Prayer is the time in which we are going through this process of evaluation and discernment, and we're going through this. And it's that time of intimacy where God, he's searching us. He's searching our heart. See, prayer is important to him. Again, not because he's a genie, but because as a father, he wants to know, what are you thinking, son? How are you thinking? Where are you thinking? See, there's this two-directional relationship that we enjoy. Prayer is talking to God. Exodus chapter 32. We have Moses, and if you notice in Exodus chapter 32, Moses in verse 11, and Moses besought the Lord his God and said, Lord, why doth thy wrath wax hot against thy people? And here you have Moses, which took a lot of courage on his part, from this verse all the way down. Moses is appealing to God, don't destroy the nation of Israel. Moses deliberately, and according to Psalms chapter 106, God says, if it wasn't for Moses, I would have destroyed the nation of Israel. So here we have Moses talking to the Lord, appealing to the Lord, please don't destroy Israel. And God said, I'll honor your request. Well, wait a minute. Can we make those kinds of requests? I mean, just think about it. I have an example of an individual, a man of God, who literally is engaged in face-to-face communication with the Lord. And you look at what he's doing. And verse 14, and the Lord repented of the evil which he thought to do unto his people. Hey, will that work for us today? Can I talk to God and tell him, you know what, I wish you would change your mind about this, and I wish you would change your mind about that, and I wish you would do this. You see, what I'm getting at is, wait a minute, I see how this individual is praying to God. Go over to 2 Samuel. And when we get to 2 Samuel, we actually have David. And King David, interesting, you can study his prayers. By the way, the book of Psalms is full of the prayers of David. Should we pray like that? Would the prayers of David serve as a pattern and as an example for us today? 2 Samuel chapter 7 and begins at verse 18. Then went King David in and sat before the Lord, and he said, so you see how he's talking to God? Who am I, O Lord God? And what is my house that thou hast brought me hither to? So from here all the way down to about verse 46, you have David rehearsing what God promises to do in and through the nation of Israel. Well, does David serve as a pattern for us to follow when it concerns prayer? We go to Daniel. Look at Daniel chapter 9. Another man of God, highly used of the Lord. Well, Daniel, he prays. And interesting, study the content of Daniel's prayer. Daniel chapter 9 and verse 1. Daniel chapter 9 verse 1. In the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus of the seed of the Medes, which was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood by books. He's studying the book of Jeremiah. Drop down to verse 3. And I set my face unto the Lord God to seek by prayer and supplications with fasting and sackcloth and ashes. And I prayed unto the Lord my God and made my confession and said, O Lord, the great and dreadful God, keeping the covenant and mercy to them that love him and to them that keep his commandments. We have sinned and have committed iniquity and have done wickedly, so on and so forth. So you know what Daniel does? He says, wait a minute, I know what's going on. The nation of Israel is in apostasy. We've rebelled. We deserve punishments that you warned us about in Leviticus chapter 26. And so Daniel says, we've sinned. He confesses the sins of the nation of Israel. And he does it again in verses 18 and 5. Here's my point. Does Daniel serve as an example and as a pattern of how we should pray? He's praying, is he not? So I could study Daniel and say, wow, isn't that interesting how he's praying there? And maybe I can learn something about prayer. We already saw the Lord Jesus Christ, right? Quickly, one more time, go to Matthew chapter 6. Now, I'll tell you what, we already saw this one, the Lord's Prayer. The Lord specifically taught his disciples to pray, our Father who art in heaven, give us this daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses. Protect us from evil. Lead us not into temptation. Well, is that prayer a pattern and an example for us to follow? We can go to the book of Acts. Go to the book of Acts real quick. Go to Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1. By the way, in the first 10 chapters of the book of Acts, there's a lot of praying going on. And the result of those prayers were supernatural in nature. Acts chapter 1, verse 24. And they prayed and said, Thou, Lord, which knoweth the hearts of all men, show whether of these two thou hast chosen, that he may take part of his ministry and apostleship. Verse 26, and they gave forth their lots, and the lot fell upon Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. And of course, according to chapter 2, Matthias was filled with the Holy Spirit. So without going through all of the opening chapters in Acts, we can study how men were praying in the book of Acts. And we can look and say, well, wait a minute. Are those prayers a pattern and an example for us to follow? Will the Holy Spirit fall down when I pray for it? Will jail cell doors open up if I pray for it? Remember when Peter, he raised up Tabitha? You know what he did first? He prayed. And you know what he prayed for? Power to resurrect a dead person, an infirm person. You have Peter praying in the book of Acts, but he's praying for healing. So here's my point, and we'll close. Romans chapter 8. Before we even learn about the Apostle Paul, we can learn a lot about prayer. How were men and women? And you know what? We didn't look at some of the women, not that I'm deliberately avoiding women, but there are men and women of God who are praying, who are talking and communing with the Lord, and they've got a lot of things to say. And you know, we could learn a lot about what they're praying about. Now we come to the Apostle Paul. And again, for the first time, writing to the body of Christ in the canon of Scripture, I'm not talking about chronologically, the foundational epistle Romans, verse 26, likewise, Romans 8, likewise the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. Did you catch what Paul just said? Did you learn about how Moses prayed, how David prayed, how Solomon prayed, how Nehemiah prayed, how Daniel prayed? Did you learn how Jesus taught how you're supposed to be praying? Did you learn how Peter and some of these other disciples were praying in early Acts? Paul says, we don't know how to do it, do we? There is a dispensational issue involved, okay? Now, we're gonna stop. The third feature is when Paul describes what prayer is ultimately all about. And that's verse 27. He that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit. God takes that time and enjoys exploring what's going on in our minds. And that really is the expectation that we should have when we talk about prayer. So we're done. We need to proactively take these steps to protect our spirit. How do we do it? Rejoice, but we also pray without ceasing. That will protect our attitude, disposition, and demeanor in life. Father, we thank you for your grace, and we do thank you for your love. We do thank you for all that we have in Christ Jesus. And as always, what a privilege to be called your sons, not just heirs, but also joint heirs with Christ. We thank you that we have the spirit of your son, where even we cry, Abba, Father. We thank you, Lord, again for your word. And as always, may it work and may it have an impact, and may it certainly touch our lives in such a way that we actually do participate in what it is you're doing in this current dispensation of grace. And we ask in Christ Jesus.